Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the new session on IBPS Prelims 2018. And today we'll be starting with the new topic of verbal reasoning. So till now we have gone through a number of topics from reasoning module, like we have discussed logical reasoning, puzzle-based questions, coding, decoding, and everything else. And today a new chapter, that is verbal reasoning. Now this is again a common part of the examination nowadays, more frequently asked in the mains examination. But sometimes you can also get questions from verbal reasoning in the prelims exams. So to understand, first of all, what is this type of reasoning and why is it separately classified as verbal reasoning? So these are those reasoning questions that are that require a lot of reading ability also. So your capability of reading something and understanding what is being given there, right? Your critical thinking ability to read, understand, make inferences, understand the assumptions, come to a conclusion, identify an argument and find out whether the argument is a weak argument or a strong argument. These are tested in the verbal reasoning part of the examination. So again, this is a type of question very different from whatever we have discussed till now, because they focus on your ability to comprehend written language, to understand an argument, to understand what information is presented in an argument, and to understand assumptions, inferences, conclusions based on that particular argument. Now, as we discuss more about this concept in detail, what are assumptions and inferences, things will become more clear to you. Also, we'll be taking up actual questions from exams for you to understand what kind of questions come and what is it that is actually being tested in such questions. Okay, so verbal reasoning jo section hai ye bahut different hai baki questions of reasoning se, kyunki yahan pe aapki jo reading ability hai wo bhi test hoti hai. Theek hai, your understanding of assumptions, conclusions, all those things will become very important. Now, the goal for the class for the first session today on verbal reasoning is to understand assumptions and inferences, okay? And we'll do that through problem discussion. Now, before we move ahead with the concept discussion for the day, let's first see the previous session CPP question, that is from Visual Reasoning Module 2. That was based on spatial reasoning ability, your ability to visualize things in three dimensions. Solve questions based on cubes and dices. That is what was spatial reasoning. And here's a question in front of you. When the figure below is folded into a cube, which figure lies opposite the face having the triangle? Now, if you had gone through the different patterns that we had discussed in the session for visual reasoning, this particular diagram that you see here is what is one of the patterns that we had discussed. We had discussed total of three patterns. So one of the patterns that was there, I think that is pattern 1, in which we had this kind of a diagram. Normally a cube when cut open has 6 faces, so we can represent it in different ways. Let us say that these are the 4 faces, and then one face of the cube is on the left hand here and one face is here. When you fold this into a box, it will become a cube box, a cube shaped box, right? Clear? So these are the 6 faces of the cube. Each face is a square. Now if I write down some numbers here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So these are the 6 faces. What we need to understand while solving such questions on cubes and dice is to understand which 2 faces will be opposite. The faces that will be opposite will definitely not be adjacent. For example, 1 and 2 you can clearly see are adjacent here. So they cannot be opposite. 2 and 3 are adjacent, 3 and 4 are adjacent, 4 and 5 are adjacent, and 5 and 6 are adjacent. Normally there is a gap of 1 square between 2 faces. For example, 2 will be opposite 4, so that we can at least tell very clearly. 2 will be opposite 4 and 3 will be opposite 5. When you fold them into a cube shaped box, 2 will be opposite 4 and 3 will be opposite 5, that means 1 will be opposite 6. Now based on this, if we see this diagram here, when the figure below is folded into a cube, which figure lies opposite the face having the triangle, that means this face. This is your face 1 and this is your face 6, and we know that 1 will be opposite 6, that means the angle, the diagram will be a triangle, okay. So which face will be opposite the triangle, just number them. Look at the pattern here on the screen and that will immediately tell you the answer is a triangle. That is why the answer for this question is B. Okay, so if you remember the patterns that we had discussed in the class, you will know exactly how to solve such questions. And if you know the pattern, this question will take hardly 4 to 5 seconds for you to solve, right? So this is a question from visual reasoning, spatial reasoning concept. In visual reasoning, we had done 2 sessions for you. One of the basic questions on series, analogy and odd one out. And the second session on visual reasoning was based on spatial reasoning, that is understanding or visualizing two-dimensional objects in 3 dimensions. Your visualization skills were tested in that particular video session. Okay, now let's start with the concept today. First of all, we have to focus on what is the meaning of an assumption and what is an inference. If the question says which of the following assumptions can be made from the statement given above, right, or which of the following assumptions follows from the statement, or which of the following inferences follows from the statement or the paragraph given to you, you need to first understand what is the meaning of an assumption and what is the meaning of an inference. And then we'll also see what is the difference between assumption and inference. Clear? Now, before we give any kind of a definition or, you know, discuss about this, let's see what the IBPS itself tells you about an assumption and inference. That is your Institute for Banking Personal Selection or even the SBI examination. In the question paper itself, when they ask you a question based on an assumption or question based on finding assumptions, they clearly specify what do they mean by assumptions. Let's first see what does IBPS or SBI themselves tell you about the word assumptions. Let's see this question. Pets are not allowed. So look at the statement here. Pets are not allowed. So this is the statement given to you. Pets are not allowed in the park premises. A notice put up at the park entrance by the authority that is responsible for maintenance of the park. This is what we mean by a statement. So this is a statement given to you. And based on that, it says which of the following can be an assumption. We will find out which of the following is an assumption according to the given information. The given information is the statement here that pets are not allowed in the park premises. So when you go to a park, you see this board there that the park management authority or the authority responsible for maintenance of the park has put up outside the park that pets are not allowed inside the park premises. So which of the following can be an assumption from the given information? We'll not solve it right now. Here we'll just see what is it that they tell you about an assumption. So this is a part of the question, right? So what they have explained here, this entire thing is given along with the question to you. Okay, so what are they telling you? That an assumption is something that is supposed or taken for granted. So this is their official definition of the word assumption. This is what the question paper setting authority is telling you about the meaning of the word assumption. So an assumption is something that is supposed or taken for granted. All right, we will discuss this in detail. This is the definition given along with the question so that you can solve the question. All right, now let's go and see the next question and understand what is the official definition of the word inference. Let's look at this question again. Read the following information carefully and answer the questions which follow. Now here we have the information. So when they say read the information carefully, this is the information they are talking about. So what is the statement here? Small brands are now looking beyond local grocery stores and are tying up with supermarkets such as Big Bazaar to pull their business out of troubled water. And then the question comes here. Which of the following can be inferred? That means we are looking for an inference from the given information. Which information? The information that small brands are now looking beyond local grocery stores and are tying up with supermarkets such as Big Bazaar to pull their business out of troubled water. Information diya hua hai, uske basis mein aapko pata karna hai ki which of the following can be inferred. Kaun sa inference aap isme se pata kar sakte hain? Aur fir question mein what is given to you? Additionally, the definition of an inference. The question ke saath mein hi definition bhi diya hua hai. You don't have to think about it, right? An inference is something that is not directly stated. So that is very clear, it is not directly stated but can be inferred. So inferred means understood from the given information. So this is the official definition of the word inference. Something that cannot, that is not mentioned directly but can be understood after reading something. So when we read something, we understand something, right? Something is given to us, something is being conveyed to us. Aapko kuch bataya ja raha hai but directly nahi. Something is there which is not mentioned directly but is expected of you to understand yourself. That is what we mean by the word inference. Now we'll see more about this. We'll understand what is the inference in detail and we'll come back to this question, solve it and get the answer. Now let's understand assumption and inference. So what is an assumption till now, what we have seen? An assumption is something that you take for granted. Now day-to-day life also we make a lot of assumptions, you know. Assumptions is something that we take for granted. Something supposed to be true. Something that is supposed to be true. Something that we take for granted. Clear? We either believe that the reader already knows about it, or that it is not important for the discussion that is happening, right? Or that we assume that it is already true and need not be told separately. That is what we mean by the assumption. So when you start from your home, let's say at 8 o'clock, to go to your college or office, and you reach your college or office at 9 o'clock on Monday and 9 o'clock on Tuesday. Now on Wednesday you again start at 8 o'clock, assuming that you will reach again at 9 o'clock. Clear? So that is an assumption that you are making, because earlier days also you took only 1 hour. So you are assuming that everything will remain constant, right? What will remain constant? The traffic will remain same. There will be no problem in your vehicle in which you are traveling, right? There is no other urgency that will happen on the way to office or college, and that everything will remain same. Then that is your assumption. What is your assumption? That everything will remain same. And based on that you are telling that if you believe that, you conclude that if you start at 8 o'clock, you will reach office at 9 o'clock. So what is your assumption here? That everything will remain as it was before. Traffic volume will not change. There will be no breakdown in the vehicle in which you are traveling. For example, your car will not break down, your bike will not break down, and there will be no other urgency which will make you stop or delay the journey from your home to college or home to office. Based on these assumptions, you make an inference, you make a conclusion that it will take you only 1 hour to reach office. So assumption is something that we suppose to be true, something that is taken for granted. Clear? For example, let's say if you're studying economics, and if you're studying the law of demand, you say that the price of the commodity has a direct relationship with demand, everything else remaining constant, right? We assume that everything else remains constant. Then you say that price of a commodity is directly related to the demand, has a direct relationship with demand. If price goes up, demand will go down. The inverse relation, not direct relationship. Price of a commodity has an inverse relationship with demand. Price goes up, demand will come down. Price goes down, demand will come up. But based on what? Based on an assumption that everything else will remain constant. Income of a person will remain constant, and his taste and preference will remain constant, and lot of other things are there which affect the demand of a commodity. So that is what we mean by an assumption. Now what is an inference? An inference is something that we, to say, inference is a logical conclusion. Inference can be defined as a logical conclusion, something that we can understand by applying some logic. For example, you see that on Monday it took you 1 hour to go from point A to point B. On Tuesday also it took you 1 hour to go from point A to point B. So this is a fact. This is something that you know, that on 2 days it took you 1 hour to go from point A to point B. So you make a logical conclusion, an inference, that on the third day also it will take you 1 hour to go from point A to point B. But for this logical conclusion, for this inference that you are making, you are also making an assumption. What is an assumption? The assumption is that everything else will remain same. The traffic volume will remain same. There will be no breakdown of vehicle. There will be no other problem on the way. So you see, assumptions and inference go hand in hand. Yeah? To come to an inference, to come to a logical conclusion, we have to make certain assumptions. So we say inference is a logical conclusion. That is why in questions you will see which of the following assumptions or inference is implicit in the statement. Implicit means hidden. So assumptions will never be mentioned in the statement. Inference will also be never mentioned in the statement. They will always be implied, understood. That is what we say in English as read between the lines. What is there between the lines? There is nothing. There is white space. When someone is asking you to read between the lines, he is telling you to look for the information that is hidden in the content, underlying information. So let's understand here. Some information is given to you directly. Let's call them as fact. Fact, or we can call them as information. So something is given to you directly in the statement. Some information that we have is underlying, which is what is called as an assumption. So fact plus assumption helps you to reach and come to an inference, a conclusion. What is an inference? An inference is a logical conclusion. A fact and an information that we have here is what we call as a premise. So there is a premise, there is some information given to you, and an assumption is an unstated premise, a fact that needs to be true for your inference to be true, but a fact which is not mentioned. So it is an unstated premise. And your inference here is the logical conclusion that you make from a particular statement. Clear? So we go through the facts, we make certain assumptions, we come to a logical conclusion. That logical conclusion is called an inference. Clear? So that is what we mean by assumptions and inferences. And for better understanding of content, for better understanding of facts and information, we need to understand how to make right assumptions and come to the right conclusion. All right. Now let's see a practical scenario. Let's say two persons are talking. Rajesh says, I read a newspaper yesterday. I read in a newspaper yesterday that in 2017, the number of patients who died in hospital ABC was more than the number of deaths reported in hospital XYZ. So Rajesh is talking about two hospitals. One is ABC and one is XYZ. And he's telling that in a newspaper he has read, that in 2017, let's say last year, the number of patients who died in hospital ABC was more than the number of deaths reported in hospital XYZ. This is a fact, right? This is a fact. And based on this, let's see what Brijesh, his friend Brijesh, he's talking to his friend Brijesh. Rajesh is talking to his friend Brijesh. What is Brijesh telling? Oh, so this means that hospital XYZ is better than hospital ABC. So here is a conclusion indicator. So Brijesh is coming to a conclusion based on the fact that is given here. The fact that Rajesh is presenting in front of Brijesh. And Brijesh says, okay, oh, that means that hospital XYZ is better than hospital ABC. This is a conclusion. Now, is the conclusion made by Brijesh correct or wrong? Or how did Brijesh come to this conclusion? How do we move from the fact to the inference or the conclusion? An inference may be right or wrong, because inference is something that is left to the listener or reader to make. So you read something and you make your own inference about it, right? It is your logical conclusion that you make. And logical conclusion is an opinion. This is your opinion. So based on the fact is not telling which hospital is better, not good or bad. The fact is just giving you a statistical information that in 2017, the number of patients who died in hospital ABC was more than that in hospital XYZ. It nowhere tells you which hospital is better or worse. Now, you as a listener, Brijesh, let's say, is making a conclusion. So, he's coming to a conclusion, which means that is Brijesh's opinion. He has used a fact, so he has come to this opinion using some logic, so it's a logical conclusion, it's an inference. But what assumptions has he made on the way to come to this conclusion? What is important in this question, you see? Is this conclusion right? Can we just tell that on the basis of number of patients, which hospital is good or bad? See, there are a number of things that we need to consider. For example, the first thing we need to consider is the number of patients in each hospital. Number of patients. This is very important information that is required to make this conclusion that Brijesh has made. Number of patients in ABC and XYZ. For example, we need to know deaths out of how many patients. Yeah? Deaths out of how many patients. Let's say that there are 100 patients in hospital ABC and the reported deaths are 10. Out of the 100 patients, 10 have died. Whereas in hospital XYZ, there are 50 patients out of which 7 have died. So 7 deaths are reported. Now you can see here the percentage of death is 10%, but here it is 14%. Now you see that although the number of deaths in ABC are more, ABC has a better record in terms of that, right? So that means when Brijesh is saying that, oh, so it means that XYZ is a better hospital than ABC, he is assuming that both the hospitals have same number of patients. This is one assumption that is being made here in order to come to the conclusion. Second is that we also need to understand the type of hospital. Are both the hospitals of the same type? Let's say ABC is a cardiac hospital, whereas XYZ is a general hospital. Now, can we compare these two? No. So, the two assumptions that are made in this particular case in order to come to the conclusion is, one, the number of deaths, number of patients in both hospitals are almost the same, and the second assumption is that both the hospitals are of the same type. Then the conclusion made by Brijesh will be right, otherwise it will be wrong. So you can see here that to move from the fact to a conclusion, you need to make certain number of assumptions. If your assumptions are right, then your conclusion is strong. If your assumptions are wrong, then your conclusion is weak. And conclusion is the main argument of the paragraph. You can say in a statement, the main argument is what is called as a conclusion. Okay, now let's see another situation here. Amit says, did you go through the notes given by Professor Ram? He has explained every concept very clearly. This is what Amit is telling to his friend Sumit. So Amit says, did you go through the notes given by Professor Ram? He has explained every concept very clearly. And Sumit says, I have not gone through these notes. As you have understood the concepts, can you explain it to me? So, what is the inference that Sumit is making? Clear? Sumit is making an inference that you have understood. That means Amit has already understood the concepts. Based on what assumption is he coming to this inference? He is assuming that Amit has gone through the concepts and he has learned everything, because Amit is telling that he has explained everything clearly. So, Sumit here assumes that Amit has already gone through the notes given by Professor Ram, and that is why he is coming to the inference that Amit has already understood the concepts, because Amit is telling that he has explained all the concepts very clearly. So, that is why Sumit is coming to an inference that Amit has understood everything, and that he can explain, can you explain it to me? Another assumption that Sumit is making here is that learning from the notes and learning from Amit who has gone through the notes will be the same. That is also one of the assumptions being made in this particular case. So understand that in day-to-day life, when we talk to each other, we make a number of assumptions and inferences, and this examination, the question type that we are talking about here, checks your ability to identify assumptions and inferences. Okay. Now let's see the previous session contest question. How many times in 24 hours do the hour hand and minute hand of a clock come together? The answer for this is 22 times. How many times they come together? 22 times. We can calculate it mathematically also and logically also. When you see a clock, we talk of an analog clock with 12 digits like 1, 2, 3, 4 around the clock, right? Between every hour, the minute hand is faster than the hour hand. So when the minute hand and hour hand are moving, in order to complete a full circle, the minute hand will have to cross over the hour hand. So every hour, the minute hand will cross over the hour hand once. So how many hours we have? 24. But 2 hours are there which we can cancel out. One is the starting 12 o'clock, because that is not a part of the day. The day starts after that, you know, after midnight 12 o'clock. And again, ending 12 o'clock also is not a part of the day. So the 12 in the night, again midnight, again same way. So 2 times we can cancel out. And that is why 24 minus 2 becomes 22. Mathematically also we can calculate. See, if you can say that the hour hand, if we use this information that the hour hand and minute hand come together, every 65 by 11 minutes. This information is one thing that you can keep in your mind. The hour hand and minute hand come together every 65 by 11 minutes. 65 by 11 means how much? 11 into 65 plus 5, 720 by 11. That means every 720 by 11 minutes, the hour hand and minute hand come together. Now in one day, how many minutes we have? Now we have 24 hours into 60 minutes, that is 1440 minutes. So if the hour hand and minute hand come together every 720 by 11 minutes, how many times will they come together in one day? We can divide 1440 by 720 upon 11. This will cancel it 2 times, multiply 11 into 2, 22 times. Logically also we can solve, and mathematically also we can solve. The answer for this question is 22 times. Now let us look at the contest question for the day today. What can be a very easy question for you? What can be the maximum gap between 2 consecutive birthday celebrations of a person born on the 29th of February? You know, when do we get 29th of February? In a leap year. So just look at the question here. What can be the maximum gap in terms of years? We're talking about in terms of years. What can be the maximum gap in terms of years between two consecutive birthday celebrations of a person born on the 29th of February? Between two consecutive birthday celebrations. Note on the question, try solving it and post the answer in the comment section. I'll be discussing the solution for this question in my next session here. Alright, so very interesting question. Let's see how many of you can solve and get the answer for this very simple question. Now moving on, let's now discuss the questions that we had seen earlier. So assumptions and inferences, we have understood the meaning of assumptions and inferences. Clear? Now let's look at this question and find out the answer for this question. Pets are not allowed in the park premises. A notice put up at the park entrance by authority that is responsible for maintenance of the park. So what are the assumptions that we can make from the given information? So you know, we make assumptions to come to an inference that already we have seen. Let's first look at these statements here. Let's look at the first one. At least some people who visit the park have pets. Can we make this particular assumption that at least some people who visit the park have pets? Let's look at the second one. This is the only park which does not allow pets. Now, first of all, this is definitely wrong. This is not what is going to be assumption. The information that is given to you is for a particular scenario. We should not go out of the scope of the discussion. We're talking about this park only, not about any other park. making assumption for anything outside the scope of the information given to you is wrong. People who ignored this notice were fined. There is no mention of any fine in the statement here. Do we mention anything about the fine? No. So that's again wrong. Clear? So that's definitely not the right answer. Let's look at the fourth statement. There are more than one entrance to the park, which is again going beyond the scope of the statement given to us. The statement just tells you that there is a board at the park entrance. Whether there are two entrances or three entrances is irrelevant, and there is no need for making any assumption which is not relevant to the information given to you. So what will happen? This fourth question also will be not the right assumption. Now let's say many people have now stopped visiting the park. That is again going out of the scope. It's not a part of the discussion. The discussion here is only about that board. Why has the park authority put that board? That should be your thought. The thought process should not be about whether there are two entrances or not, or what will happen if people, you know, will people stop coming to the park? Or we should not start discussing about what about other parks? You know, do other parks also have such boards or not? Our main aim is to understand here, why have parks authority put that board? What could be a reason behind that? Okay, now that means that it is definite that some people who were visiting the park had pets, and maybe those pets were creating some kind of inconvenience for other visitors in the park. Clear? And this is the reason why the park authority had to put a board that pets are not allowed in the park premises. You see, that is why a board is put. That is why this is your correct assumption. If you see somewhere, if you feel, let's say go to a park, or you see you go to a mall or a restaurant, and you see that smoking is not allowed here, what does it mean? It means that at least some people who come there normally smoke, and that is why it is assumed that some people who would be visiting the restaurant are smokers, and we need to tell them very clearly that smoking is not allowed. That is an assumption why a restaurant is putting up a board saying that smoking is not allowed here. Clear? So they don't have to come to the exact conclusion based on anything. They just need to know, make an assumption that yes, smoking is a common habit, so there are definitely number of people who smoke, and some of the customers who would come to our restaurant would definitely be smokers, and that is why we need to inform them in advance that we don't allow smoking here. Similarly, the park authority is assuming that some of the visitors who come to park must be having pets, and that is why we need to tell them in advance that in this park pets are not allowed. Let's go to the next question and see what is an inference and how do we solve an inference based question. Look at this statement here. Small brands are now looking beyond local grocery stores and are tying up with supermarkets such as Big Bazaar to pull their business out of troubled waters. Which of the following can be inferred from the given statement? Again, we already know what is an inference. It is never stated directly, but you are supposed to understand it logically. You have to come to this conclusion after reading a particular statement. So before we go to the answer option, let's try to understand what is this statement telling us. Small brands are looking beyond local grocery stores. That means there are some brands which are small, some brands which are big. That is definitely can be assumed and inferred from this particular statement, that some brands are small, some brands are big. The small brands are looking beyond local grocery stores. In addition to local grocery stores, they are not going to stop selling at local grocery stores. They are looking beyond local grocery stores. And what are they doing? Tying up, collaborating, partnership with supermarkets. They want to start selling their products at supermarkets. Now we know in urban centers like Bangalore and Delhi and many other places, in smaller towns and cities, now have the concept of supermarkets. We have Big Bazaar and Star Bazaar and so in different types of supermarkets. So the smaller brands are now looking beyond local grocery stores and tying up with supermarkets such as Big Bazaar. Clear? One example of a supermarket is Big Bazaar to pull their business out of troubled waters. What does this part here tell? Pull their business out of troubled waters. To pull something out of troubled waters means difficulty. So their business is in a difficult situation or difficult position, difficult condition. That is what we mean by something is in troubled waters. Clear? So that means, what is the meaning of business being in difficult situation? That means the business is not doing well. And in order to solve this problem, they want to tie up a supermarket. So what are the smaller brands assuming? The smaller brands think that supermarkets will help them solve their problem of not having sufficient big business. And what is the inference that we can make out of this? That since smaller brands think that going to supermarkets will solve the problem, that means we can infer from it that there is a perception among small brands, there is a thinking among small brands that sale in supermarket is higher than that of local grocery stores. Right? This is the inference that we can make, because we see that smaller brands are trying to tie up with supermarkets. So there must be a reason for that. The reason is that the smaller brands think that they are of the view that sale in supermarkets will be more than sales in local grocery stores. That is how they will be able to come out of the troubled waters, that means out of the difficulty that their business is facing right now. Okay, all right. Now let's look at the continuation of the same question. Same statement is here. Small brands are now looking beyond local grocery stores and are tying up with supermarkets such as Big Bazaar to pull their business out of troubled waters. Now, these questions, directions are here. These questions are based on the information given above and the sentences labeled A, B, C, D, E, and F as given below. So, there are some questions based on these statements here. Okay, so you can see in the slides further, we'll see questions based on this statement and some sentences labeled A, B, C, D, E, F below. So, what is sentence A? Let's look at sentence number A. A small brand manufacturing a certain product of quality comparable with that of bigger brand makes much more profit from the local grocery stores than from supermarkets. Second statement says, as the supermarkets have been set up only in bigger cities at present, this step would fail to deliver results in the smaller cities. C says, supermarkets help the smaller brands break into newer markets without investing substantially in distribution. D says supermarkets charge the small brands 10% higher than the amount charged to bigger brands. E says being outnumbered by the bigger brands, visibility of the smaller brands at local grocery stores is much lower as compared to the supermarkets. And F tells you smaller brands are currently making substantial losses in their business. Then we have questions like this. Let's look at the question types. Then we'll go back and see what to do with those statements. Which of the statements numbered A, B, C, D, E, and F can be assumed from the facts given above? So that means we have to find the primary assumption hidden in this statement. So out of the statements A, B, C, D, E, F, which is an assumption? Second is, which of the statements numbered A, B, C, E, and F, not D, okay? A, B, C, E, and F represents a disadvantage. That means we have to look for disadvantages and advantages of the smaller grocery stores over supermarkets from the perspective of a smaller brand. So we have to look for which statement tells you about an advantage of small grocery stores, which statement tells you about a disadvantage of small grocery stores, which statement tells you about an advantage of the supermarkets, and which is telling you about a disadvantage of supermarkets. Next we have, which of the following statements mentioned above represents a reason for the shift from local grocery stores to supermarket? Why would you shift? Because of advantages of supermarket. That means you have to find out which statements give you positive points about supermarkets. And let's look at the last question here. Which of the statements numbered A, B, C, E, and F mentioned above would prove that the step taken by the smaller brands may not necessarily be correct? That means it would not be good to move from local grocery stores to supermarkets. That means we are looking for advantages of local grocery stores compared with disadvantages of supermarkets. Okay. So this is what we have to look for. That means from these statements here A, B, C, D, E, F, what all we need to find? One, we have to find out which statement can be an assumption made from the given information. Second, we look for advantages of local grocery stores. Which statements tell you about positive points about local grocery stores? Which statement tells you about negative points about the move from local grocery stores to supermarkets? We also have to look for those statements which tell you about the advantages of supermarkets and also disadvantages. It will go hand in hand. Let's see for the first one. A smaller brand manufacturing a certain product of quality comparable with that of bigger brand. So the assumption here is that the product quality is same, makes much more profit from local grocery stores. That means this is a local grocery store plus. Generalized writing plus here, it's a positive point for local grocery stores as compared to supermarkets. That means the move from local grocery stores to supermarkets will not be a good move based on statement number A. Let's look at the second statement. As the supermarkets have been set up only in bigger cities at present, this step would fail to deliver results in smaller cities. This is not relevant. So in this case, what we could do is we could say that, okay, in smaller cities, these smaller brands will continue selling in local grocery stores, and in bigger cities, they can tie up with supermarkets. So there's no problem with the statement. We can't say about plus or minus advantages or disadvantages. We can simply ignore the statement. Go to the third one. Supermarkets help the smaller brands break into newer markets without investing substantially. That means this is a positive statement for supermarkets. Okay, this is a positive statement for supermarkets. Next, go to D. Supermarkets charge the smaller brands 10% higher than they charge to the bigger brands. So this is a negative statement. The supermarkets are discriminating. They are penalizing these smaller brands. So this is a negative step for supermarket. This is a negative point for supermarket. Let's go to E. Being outnumbered by the bigger brands, visibility of the smaller brands at local grocery stores is much lower as compared to the supermarkets. So it's a negative point for local grocery stores, positive point for supermarkets. This would be a good reason to move from the local grocery stores to supermarkets. And F, smaller brands are currently making substantial losses in their business. This is our valid assumption because we know that their business is in troubled waters. From this, we can assume, we can tell that, okay, that means that the smaller brands are making substantial losses. Clear? The business is in troubled waters. So for question number 1, the answer will definitely be F because that is what we are looking for, assumption. Question number 2, which of the statements numbered A, B, C, E, N, F represent a disadvantage of the smaller grocery stores over supermarkets? So one is statement E. So statement E is definitely one of the answers. Look at E. So A is not the answer, B is not the answer, here we can say A is not the answer, C is not the answer. F is not the answer, B and C, because we definitely know that E is one of the statements. So the answer will become only E. Just let me erase this part here. Okay. All right. Now going to the third one. Which of the statements mentioned above represents a reason for the shift? So there should be an advantage of supermarkets over local grocery stores. Which of the points is definitely one of the reasons? One point is E, because here their visibility is much lesser in local grocery stores as compared to supermarkets. That is definitely. And C is also one of the major reasons behind this particular thing. So we see SM plus is here, SM plus is here. So we can say here both C and E. And finally, for the fourth question, which of the statements numbered A, B, C, E, and F mentioned above would prove that the step is not correct? May not necessarily be correct. So advantages of local grocery stores, we are looking for advantages of local grocery stores. You see here LG plus, so A is definitely one of the advantages of local grocery stores. So A must be and the answer option. If you see here, none of these other answer options contain A. So answer will be only A. So the answer for the fourth question is only A. Now you see how we had approached the question. First we looked at each question to find out what each question is asking. Read the statement given to you, about the smaller brands and this 6 sentences given to you A, B, C, D, E, F, and write down which of them is a disadvantage, advantage based on the questions here, and that will help you solve questions in the exam without any difficulty. So in detail we have discussed the topic of assumption and inference in this particular video. What is the meaning of assumption? What is the meaning of inference? Also the official definition of assumption and inference. Also we have seen questions from actual examinations based on assumptions and inferences. Alright, so go through the video once again and make sure that you have understood every point that is discussed here, so that tomorrow when you get a question based on assumption and inference, you can get it 100% correct. So now is the time for the class practice pack, in which I have selected 10 questions for you from the topic of assumptions and inference. For those who have passport access, once you hear the sound, you can start solving the questions immediately. The question that most of you get wrong, I will be discussing in my next session. So best of luck to you, and thank you.